Good morning all. In this class we will discuss the classification of heat treatment for the steels, different classification of heat treatment, also the requirements for the heat treatment, the operating temperature involved in the different heat treatment process, different stages of heat treatment, and the medium in which the heat treatment process is carried out, the cooling and heating is carried out. Okay, the basic classification of the heat treatment of steel involves the first one is the heating and rapid cooling, or also called as heating plus quenching, and another classification is heating plus slow cooling. So definitely it involves a heating process and also a cooling process. At the same time, in a certain condition it involves heating plus holding at that particular temperature for a period of time, then cooling in a particular environment at a faster rate or slower rate. So next we will discuss the major requirements of the purpose for the heat treatments, or what are the factors which determines we are going for this heat treatment. The first important feature for heat treatment is like it can be used for improving the ductility of the steels. So when we are discussing the heat treatment, we will be restricting like the heat treatment process of the steel. So in terms of steel we will be discussing. So first important property is it can improve the ductility of the steels. It can relieve the internal stresses developed inside the material. It can refine the grains. It can recrystallize and it can rearrange the grain structure. So it can be used for grain refinement. It can increases the hardness of the steels and also the strength. So there are certain heat treatment process that can improve the ductility, and there are other heat treatment process which can improve the hardness of the steel. It can improve the machinability, toughness of the steels, and also it can improve the surface properties or surface hardness. Which by the term surface hardness we means we will be having a good hardness of the surface, but inner core the steel will be having its previous property. So hardening property will be retained only on the surface. Though that particular classification is called as surface hardening treatments. So the various factors which are involved in the heat treatment process. If we are considering the heat treatment process stage by stage, we can see we have to have a mandatory heat treatment temperature. The what temperature we are doing this heat treatment process. So first we have to optimize that. And another important term is the soaking time. How much duration we will be holding that particular heat treatment temperature, the material at that particular heat treatment temperature, which is the soaking time. So it is the length of the time the material is held at the higher temperature or elevated temperature. The third important factor is the rate of cooling. At what cooling rate we will be employing? Already we have discussed like depending upon the cooling rate, the phases achieved in the material are differ. So we can achieve very slow pearlite cooling rate, we can achieve pearlite structure which is very soft material, and at a very high cooling rate we can achieve martensite structure which is very hard material. So depending upon the cooling rate also, the final structure or the final properties of the material will be dependent. So the rate of cooling is one other important factor, and the medium of medium of the atmosphere in which we are doing the heat treatment process, the surrounding atmosphere or the heat treatment environment in which we will be doing this process. So that are the various factors which affects the heat treatment process. Now we will be discussing the different classification of the heat treatment, the overall classification of the heat treatment. So as a whole we can classify heat treatment as first classification as the simple heat treatment process, in under which it comes process annealing, full annealing process, spiritizing process, normalizing. So the simple heat treatment process mainly involve the types of annealing and normalizing process. The next classification comes the quench and temper heat treatment process. By quenching we means very fast cooling. So very fast cooling and heating process, which is that quench and temper heat treatment process, which is exclusively done for hardening purpose. So it have the classification hardening heat treatment as well as the tempering heat treatment. The third classification is the isothermal heat treatment process, which is austempering, martempering and marquenching. The fourth classification is the precipitation hardening process, exclusively for improving the hardness properties of the steels. Last one is the surface treatments. We already told like we will be having a very good hardened surface, but inner region or the core of the material will be having a different property. So hardening will be taking place at the outer surface, which is having much more exposure to the different environment. So hardened surface we can obtain using surface hardening heat treatment. Mainly it involves the diffusion method like carburizing, cyaniding, nitrating and carbon nitrating process. And also another classification of hardening or the surface hardening treatment is flame hardening, induction hardening, laser hardening and selective carburizing treatments. So we'll be discussing each one of these heat treatment processes in detail in the future classes. Next important feature which involves the heat treatment process is the medium of quenching. So we have mentioned like the quenching process is actually the cooling process. How easily we are cooling the material, or at what cooling rate we are doing the cooling. So cooling of the steel. So that also determines the properties as well as the structure of the steel as well as the faces. So the effect of quenching medium or effect of the cooling medium is having a greater significance. So the commonly used quenching mediums are air, oil, water, or the furnace also can be considered as a medium of quenching or cooling. So air is having comparatively slower severity of quench. The hardness obtained by using air as a medium of quenching is small. When we are coming to the oil, it will be having a moderate severity of the quenching. The hardness obtained is comparatively higher. Water is having very large severity of quenching. So hardness obtained is very large. And if you are using furnace as the medium of quenching, which means if you are doing the heating process inside the furnace, and once we reach the operating temperature and we are holding for a sufficient period of time, then what we used to do is we used to cut off the operating temperature so that very gradually the material which is kept inside the furnace, it will be cooled inside the furnace itself. So it will be having much much more lower cooling rate when compared to that of the air. So if you are classifying the severity of the quench or the order of quench, we'll be having the fastest quenching rate for the water, followed by the oil, then followed by the air, then followed by the cooling inside the furnace. Okay, so for annealing or normalizing heat treatments, normally we used to do this cooling or cooling process inside either air or inside the heat treatment furnace itself. For the hardening heat treatment process, commonly we will be employing either water or oil, which is having significantly higher quenching rate. So another important factor which we determine for the heat treatment process is which is significant for the heat treatment process is the operating temperature and also the operating the composition of the constituent steel, whether it is a low carbon steel, whether it is a medium carbon steel, or whether it is high carbon steel. So in the starting stage itself, we have mentioned like we will be discussing exclusively the heat treatment of steels. So we have to restrict the region where our heat treatment study is involved. So you can see in the iron carbon diagram, you'll be choosing an area which is exclusively the region of the steel. So you can see the blue rounded region which actually represents our heat treatment region for the steel. So we'll be avoiding all other region, because what we need is like we need an operating temperature which is closer to 1500 or less than 1100 degrees centigrade, where the steel exists in the austenite phase at higher temperature. And we will be going for a composition range which is less than 2 or 2.1%, because we know the steel in an iron carbon system can exist over a range from 0 to 2.1%, above which it is a cation. So we will be restricting our region of study to a temperature range of 1000 or 1100 degrees centigrade, and also to a composition range of 0 to 2.1%. That's why we have highlighted it in a particular region. So we will be focusing for all the heat treatment study in this region only. So you can see this is actually the enlarged view of the previous sections, the previous iron carbon diagram. The region we have mentioned like we'll be going maximum up to 1000 degree centigrade, and also the composition region for our requirement of study is the maximum for the high carbon steel, which normally have a maximum composition of less than 2 or 1.6% of carbon. So our axis at the x-axis will be having the composition of carbon, and y-axis will be having the temperature, similar to the iron carbon system, but the region of focus is restricted to the region where the steel is existing, the low carbon, medium carbon and high carbon steel is existing. And here the different regions where the different types of heat treatment process is carrying out is mentioned: the spiritizing process, full annealing process, normalizing process, in terms of the temperature range as well as the composition region. We will be coming to it in detail later. So we will start with the first kind of the heat treatment process, which is annealing heat treatment process. So as any type of heat treatment process, basic steps involved are, we'll be heating up to a required temperature range, we'll be holding for sufficient period of time, then we'll be cooling to the room temperature, okay, at the required cooling rate and in the required cooling environment. So these are the basic three stages involved in the any types of heat treatment process. So the first kind of cooling, first kind of the heat treatment process is the annealing heat treatment process, in which we'll be exposing to an elevated temperature for a long period of time, then we'll be slowly cooling such that the phase transformation takes place. So it is commonly employed for low carbon steels as well as medium carbon steels. And we can classify the annealing heat treatment process further into full annealing process, process annealing process, or also called as stress relieving annealing, and the last one is the spiritizing annealing process. Okay. So as I mentioned earlier, the three stages of annealing involves, first one is heating to the desired temperature range, which is the stage one. Here the material is austenized by heating 15 to 40 degree above the A3 line or A1 lines in the iron carbon diagram, and until the complete composition in the steel it changes to its austenitic phase. Also this process is called as austenizing process. The second stage is actually the soaking time or holding time. The material is held at that particular austenizing temperature range for a longer period of time, for even 1 hour we can hold at that particular temperature range. The third stage involves cooling to the room temperature, and this is normally done inside the furnace. So what is the significance of heating to a temperature range above A3 line and A1 line? So in the figure you can see enlarged view of that particular region in the iron carbon diagram, you can see this A3 line as well as the A1 line. These are two important lines when we are comparing the heat treatment process. The A1 line, you already know, it is the eutectoid line which exists at 723 degrees centigrade, and A3 line and ACM line, you can see A3 line towards the left side of the hyper eutectoid steels, because less than 0.8% carbon, you can see at the top region, it is the boundary which separates the austenite phase, or the boundary of the austenite phase. And ACM line, similarly, it is the separating boundary for the austenite phase in the steels which is hyper eutectoid steel. So A3 line as well as ACM line actually represents the boundary, limiting boundary of the austenite phase. A1 line actually represents the eutectoid temperature line. So A1 line, A3 line, ACM lines, these lines are actually called as critical temperature line. By critical temperature line, the A1 line actually represents the lower critical temperature, it is called as the lower critical temperature. A3 line actually represents the upper critical temperature. So in future, if you are discussing in the heat treatment process, if you are telling the term it is lower critical temperature, we have to understand that it is the eutectoid temperature line and it corresponds to 723 degrees centigrade. And if we are mentioning heating above or heating below the upper critical temperature, we have to understand it is the A3 line, which actually is the phase boundary of the austenite phase. So A1 is actually lower critical temperature line or eutectoid temperature line, A3 is the upper critical temperature. This is very important when we are dealing with the annealing heat treatment process. And we have mentioned the three stages: heating, soaking or holding, cooling to the room temperature. In the case of annealing, we'll be doing the cooling process in a temperature range which is in the temperature in the environment, which is the inside the furnace itself. So after sufficient amount of soaking time, what we used to do, we'll be cutting off the heating furnace. So gradually the temperature in the furnace will be getting decreased, and it will reaches the room temperature over a period of time. It takes even longer hours. So from room temperature, from higher temperature, the operating temperature of the furnace or the soaking temperature, to reach the room temperature, it is a very slower cooling process and it takes longer period of time. And the heating and the cooling rate normally involved is 100 degree Fahrenheit per hour. So that much slower is the cooling rate if you are using a furnace for the cooling process. Main purpose of annealing process, the first one is to relieve the internal stresses which is developed inside the material during any strain hardening process or cold working process. You already know the different cold working process are actually creating or increasing the dislocations inside a material, and also it is a strengthening process, the cold working or strain hardening process. Different examples involve the rolling process, forging process or machining process. All these are different process, and welding process, all these can induce different amount of stresses inside a material. So if you are heating this material after this cold working or welding or casting or forging, we can relieve these internal stresses which is developed inside the material during these manufacturing processes. So what will happen is, like, these different defects or these different strains which are induced during the manufacturing process can act as the stress raisers in future, or it can act as the reason for originating or of distortion or cracks. So if you are relieving it by suitable annealing heat treatment process, we can relieve the internal stresses which is developed. At the same time, we can limit the possibility of any mechanical failure of that particular component. So annealing actually help to relieve the internal stresses, and also it can reduce the chance of the distortion or cracking resulted due to that. The second important purpose of annealing is it can increase the ductility property of the material, softness of the material, the cutting ability or the machinability of the material. Also it improve the metal formability, because as the temperature, as we are heating at a slower rate and cooling, if you are heating at a higher temperature and cooling at a slower rate, definitely the ductility property will be increasing, the grain coarsening will be increased, so also the softness of the material get increased. So easily we can deform the material and machinability of the material getting increased. So it is very suitable to do the annealing process immediately after the forming process to relieve the internal stresses as well as to improve the softness of the material, because during any manufacturing process there is a tendency that it compromise over the ductility property, or this strain which is induced reduces the ductility form as well as the formability of the material. So the second important purpose of annealing is it make the material ductile as well as soft, improve the machinability. The third important process is it can result in the grain refinement. Actually we can improve the grain refinement of the material. So the cold working process like rolling or forging, we will be having a directional orientation of the grains, such that, like, for example, in the case of rolling, we'll be having elongated grains after the rolling process. So if you are doing the heat treatment process, this can be reconverted, these elongated grains can be reconverted to its initial equiaxed grain structure. So the grain refinement is also possible in the case of annealing. So main purpose involves relieving the internal stress, number one. Number two is the improving the ductility and softness, machinability of the material. Third one, it is grain refinement of the material. So next we will discuss the first classification of annealing, which is the process annealing, which is also called as intermediate annealing. So in this case, a heat treatment is done to reduce the exclusively for reducing the effect of cold working or strain hardening, or the mechanical plastic deformation which we use for doing the forming process. So in this process, the annealing parts are not completely softened, or it is not, the internal stresses will be completely relieved, but the material will not be completely made ductile. That's the reason why it is called as an intermediate annealing, or it is a part annealing process. So in the case of full annealing, we will be having complete regaining of the ductility properties, but in the case of this process annealing, we will be having a partial recovery of the ductility property, but it will completely relieve the internal stresses which is developed during this process. This process annealing, actually it is used as one intermediate stage when we are doing any manufacturing process. The process annealing or the stress relieving annealing, it is frequently used as intermediate heat treatment step during the manufacturing of any part or component. So the different stages which is involved in this process annealing involves the recovery process and the recrystallization process. So recrystallization process is actually, it is the recovery process is actually the regaining of the initial property of the material, and recrystallization process involves the restructuring of the grains, or the refinement of the grains. For example, if you are considering a manufacturing process or the cold working process, for example the rolling manufacturing process, we can see when we are passing the material bulk or ingot in between these two rollers, and in the details we can see the grain structure, the change in the grain structure which is happening. In the initial ingot, before it enters the rollers, it will be having a equiaxed or almost equal size grains, but when it is passed through the rollers, depending upon the direction in which the rolling process is for carrying out, whether it is a forward rolling or backward rolling, we can see the alignment, the grains are getting aligned, or it is getting aligned over a particular direction. Okay, so we can see the grains are getting distorted, or it is getting elongated. So these types of grain changes or the grain structural changes happens after the different types of forming or manufacturing processes. And if you are doing the heat treatment process, the process annealing heat treatment process or the intermediate annealing heat treatment process, immediately after this forming, metal forming process, we can again reconvert these elongated grains to its previous grains or the EQX grains. So that is one important process when we are comparing the when we are retaining the properties in the material even after the manufacturing process. So it is commonly employed for low carbon steels or the steels in which the carbon composition is less than 0.25%. And here the heat treatment process, as mentioned, it is a intermediate heat treatment process. So the heat treatment temperature, it is not very high. Like normally we'll be heating to a temperature range which is lower than the lower critical temperature. So normally the temperature operating range is 550 to 650 degrees centigrade, or it is well below the A1 line or the lower critical temperature line. So already I have discussed the upper critical temperature line is the A3 line, the lower critical temperature line is the A1 line or the eutectoid line. So in the case of process annealing, we will be heating a temperature range less than lower critical temperature range, so less than 723 degrees centigrade, which is 550 to 650 degrees centigrade, and we will be holding for the sufficient period of time. Then the cooling process we will be doing in the air. So heating up to 550 to 650 degree, that is the first stage, holding for the sufficient period of time, second stage, which is the soaking time, third stage, cooling to the room temperature in the air. This process, the process annealing process, it is also called as intermediate annealing, and it is having another name which is called as subcritical annealing. So in the figure you can see the region in which we have using this process annealing. It is marked over the process annealing. It is commonly used for the composition range which is low carbon steel, which is less than 0.25% carbon. So the region in which it happens also is marked, and the temperature range also it is marked. It is done at the range which is less than 723 degree centigrade, so the lower temperatures and range which is less than 723 degree range, it is also marked over there. Okay, so the next classification of annealing is the full annealing process. So it is mainly done for achieving the complete ductility of the material or the complete full advantage of the annealing process. So again, the operating temperature at which we are heating, it depends upon the material composition or the percentage of carbon. So we commonly employ this for low carbon steel as well as the high medium carbon steel. So in the case of hyper eutectoid steel, you know, for the steel in which the carbon content is less than 0.8% carbon, for the hyper eutectoid steel we will be heating the material above the upper critical temperature. Upper critical temperature is the A3 line. For the case of hyper eutectoid steel or the steel in which the carbon content is less than 0.8%. So for the case of hyper eutectoid steel, we will be heating above lower critical temperature. This is very important. You can see in the given figure the region in which the full annealing process, it is marked as a gray shaded region. So you can see for the case of eutectoid steel, as I mentioned, the carbon content less than 0.8%. If you are observing the figure, you can see in that region, the gray region actually exists above the A3 line. A3 line is actually the upper critical temperature. And when we are going to the region where above 0.8% of carbon, which is hyper eutectoid range, there you can see the full annealing process is carried out above the A1 line. A1 line is the lower critical temperature. For hyper eutectoid steel, above A3 line or upper critical temperature. For hyper eutectoid steel, above lower critical temperature or A1 line. This point is very important in the heat treatment of full annealing process. So the operating temperature range above upper critical as well as above lower critical for hypo and hyper eutectoid steel. The second stage involves the soaking time. We will be holding at the sufficient period of time, and it may take a longer period of time. And that time when the steel actually completely austenize or completely convert to austenite phase, that particular process is an isothermal holding process, so it also called as austempering process. The third stage involves the cooling process. So the cooling process in the case of annealing, it involves cooling inside the furnace. So inside the furnace, the cooling process, it is the slowest cooling process. Upon very slow cooling inside the furnace, the austenite which is observed obtained in the material, it again decomposes to ferrite and cementite. So during this process, whatever the internal stresses developed inside the material, it is completely relieved, and also the ductility of the material is very much improved. So the material will get softened, and as well as the mechanical properties are also enhanced. So the main purpose of doing the full annealing is it removes the structural imperfection by complete recrystallization process. It relieves the internal stresses. The grain refinements takes place in the material. Okay, in the next class, we will be discussing the other classification of annealing process, which is spheroidization annealing. And also we will be discussing the normalizing heat treatment process. Okay, thank you.